This episode of the Disney Nerds Podcast is brought to you by TouringPlans.com. Spend less time in line and more time riding your favorite attractions. Visit TouringPlans.com.
Hey everybody, it's Stacy from Must Do Disney, and you are in the place to be, the Disney Nerds Podcast. Check it out.
Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome. Welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast, a place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
A Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the Magic Worlds of Disney.
Hello and welcome to show number 470 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey guys, how's it going? And welcome back to the show. On this week's show, well, you know what? There's so much going on down at Walt Disney World and at Disneyland. We're going to be talking news this week. To help me do that, I've got a couple great newscasters. The first one is Melissa. Hey, Melissa, how's it going?
Hey, everyone. Excited to talk about some news and see what's going on down there. Need an update before I leave.
Yeah, definitely. And we also have Jimmy. Hey, Jimmy, how's it going?
I'll let Melissa live with the great moniker. I'm gonna say I'm probably just okay.
He's coming off of the Disney blues.
I am not. You know what? Ed has accused me, and it's probably true, of not recording the week after I get back from a trip and kind of zoning out for a little while when I get back, which is probably true. I'm not saying it's not. So I made it a special point to be here tonight.
Oh, yeah, no doubt. And you were, from the first day back, you were answering texts and getting in touch with people. So definitely worked out better this time. And for those of you waiting for it, the trip report from both Jimmy and Morgan, we're going to have those next week. Morgan's just getting back tonight, and she's kind of relaxing and getting herself back into the scheme of things. So I figure we're going to save the trip reports together for those two for next week. Is that okay, Jimmy?
It was marvelous.
Oh, I'm sure it was a good trip. We saw a lot of good pictures. The convention looked pretty outstanding. The House of Mouse.
House of Mouse was a lot of fun.
Nice.
Got to see a lot of people we don't normally see. So it's interesting because we're one of the only ones that are there as a podcast. That, you know, most of the stuff there is either they're either celebrities, they're artists, or they're selling something.
Right.
And we do none of those. So we podcast, but you know, it's an interesting thing because we don't really sell anything. So we just have a booth there to meet people. And we did have a nice little gift basket that we did a drawing for and gave away. I got to meet some very cool celebrities. I got an autograph from Boo from Monsters, Inc. on a pop. Nice. I was supposed to get Brett Iwan beside my Mickey pop, but he rolled out a little right before I was about to go get him. So I missed him. So,
oh, well, maybe next time.
Yeah, maybe next time. I did get celebrities a couple weeks ago before we went. I did go to Fan Expo in New Orleans and got Paige O'Hara and Jodie Benson's autographs on some Funko Pops. So that's cool too.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Got to get yourself a nice collection there.
Yep. It's all for sale. Email Jimmy at... No, I'm kidding. It's not for sale.
Everything is for sale.
Yes.
Okay, guys. Well, so this was a very, very busy news week, and probably the biggest news story happened on Monday, and that was the closing of one of the classic rides at Walt Disney World. Got to say, Splash Mountain. Monday it closed, and it did not disappoint. The lines were all the way into Liberty Square. So people did not disappoint trying to get there for their last ride through. Did you guys see anything or did you hear anything about it when you were down there?
So we were watching the rides on Sunday. while we're at the wait times, while we're at the expo. Yeah, it was pretty crazy. We were there. I was in Magic Kingdom Wednesday, and it was down for most of the day. And then as soon as it came out, they got a long line, so I never got to ride it.
Typical.
It was literally down most of the day on that Wednesday. And then once it came up, like, boom, the line was so long. I'm like, God, dog it. Oh, well.
Well, Jimmy, it would have been worth it because I hear that if you would have just grabbed a mason jar or a Disney cup or a bottle of water, any container you could get your hands on and just scoop a little bit of water, you could be earning $10,000 right now.
Wait a minute. I did ride it on Wednesday, and I got this bottle right here full of water that I'm willing to sell. Email me at jimmy@...
Yeah. Sucker.com.
Yeah.
Which is amazing, and what we're talking about is it's true. There's plenty of people on eBay who have the water posted that they supposedly got on the last day, and they are literally containers with labels written onto them. Hey, we got it on 1/23/23. You know, at what time of the day and stuff like that. I love the ones who actually say they got water and rocks. So
you know how stupid this is.
It is, but
you understand that once it's rethemed, it's going to be the same water, right?
And just so you guys who haven't heard,
and the water's gone,
the water goes in a tank. If you've ever done the Keys of the Kingdom tour, the water goes when they drain it, it goes into a tank behind the scenes.
You're just ruining my child's college tuition fund.
So now, is there any chance this will not come back as a water ride?
No, absolutely not.
Fair enough. Just saying.
All right. So, interesting enough, and if you have not seen it, I highly recommend seeing the Imagineering story on Disney+, because I'm currently rewatching that. And the other night, just getting home from my trip, I'm to the point where they were building Splash Mountain, which is pretty cool and kind of also sad.
Sure. There are a lot of history behind that mountain, and considering it wasn't part of the original park, that makes it kind of special, I guess.
What I found interesting was that the Disney community, fairly insular, right? We know each other, we report news, and we find small things as a big deal. Splash Mountain getting shut down, it's devastating, you've had many memories on it and things, but it stays pretty much within the Disney community. What I saw happen over the weekend was our local news channel in Midwest USA of 10,000, 12,000 people talking about this, that the ride shut down, it was no more, and that water was being sold in, you know, $1,000, $10,000, and you could go on eBay for it, and people talking about it. That is, I saw it on CBS Sunday morning, even, that it was just,
yeah, I think it's just
cultural phenomena. And I wonder if it's just that juncture. It's been around for a long time. Many people have ridden it. It's sort of that juncture of a little bit of a political debate of the ride shutting down, which we don't need to get into, but you know what it's switching to and that it's moving and changing, and then the water and everything. So it's just sort of interesting that it's made its way outside of the Disney community on the news and things. But it's silly. People beware.
If you're interested in this other bottle, I have some water from Maelstrom.
Still, you held on to that.
That I've been holding on to, waiting to sell. So,
unfortunately, this news story has two big factors. One, it has Walt Disney or the Disney name in it, which always gets notoriety. The other factor is it's taking advantage of making fun of a group of adults who like to do kid rides, is basically the gist of it. So those two things come together, and it's a hell of a funny joke.
Going back to the Maelstrom thing, I did have somebody try and make the argument that you can tell how popular of a ride Splash Mountain was because of the long line on the last day. And I said, well, that thought process just doesn't track, because the same thing happened to Maelstrom, and it wasn't it wasn't that popular a ride until they said it was going away.
Sure. And that was, you're right about that. And as soon as they said it was going away, the line was huge right up until the end. Splash wasn't like that, though. Splash literally was, I think, the last 2 days, and that was it. Before that, it was pretty much just still the same. Now I'm looking forward to this. This is going to be a good change. It's going to be interesting, that little section of the park there. They had a big part where they shut down after opening the train for how many years. They shut down the train station there at Splash Mountain, which I thought was kind of odd, but I guess they're going to have to do that for construction and such like that. At least we'll be able to see updates as we're going through there. They can't close it all off.
I wish they would have given us an opportunity to visit ESPN Club at the boardwalk one last time, like before they made a cake.
Big line outside.
You want to steal a beer glass yeah. or something?
Yes, correct. Before they made a cake shop out of it. Yes. Oh, it's sad. Yeah. It's sad looking right now.
Oh, I can imagine it. It probably looks like abandoned over there.
Well, there's walls up, but like if you look up, you know, I mean, it had that iconic kind of tower. And it's all steel beams. So they've completely, they must have had something going on with that building.
Oh, like where they had to redo something?
Yeah, I mean, like the walls are gone. Like there's steel beams up there. Like they've torn down the whole outside. They're not just doing an interior remodel. Like everything's gone.
There's no way ESPN's coming back here.
No, it's not. And there's signs all around it that says the big shop or whatever. And I will say the cake looks good.
Yeah, well, any cake looks good. Okay, guys. So another news story was, and this is kind of something we've been teasing and they've been teasing us about, was the Toy Story sit-down restaurant that's been supposedly coming for the longest time. The Toy Story Roundup Rodeo Barbecue, which now we have an opening date and we have a full menu for, which I thought was pretty cool. The opening date is going to be March 23rd. So we're very much looking forward to that. That's just right down the road. And the menu itself is, well, it's pretty much straight barbecue. The only thing is, it looks like it's going to be a family serve type of restaurant where you're going to choose the salads and then your mains come out and then you have your choices of the sides. Have you guys heard anything about this, or have they had any food tastings coming up yet? They got to be close to that.
Yeah, I'm excited to try the Prospector's homemade cheddar biscuits with sweet pepper jelly. It looks like it's one of the starts that you get as your bread basket. You know, kind of traditional looking biscuit, and the jelly is served on the side. But that's always a good first start when you get free chips or, you know, eat rolls or whatever, you know.
Right. Now, I did not see a pricing breakdown with this, so it's going to be interesting to see what it is. However, I'm probably going to say it's going to be close to the other type of places that are similar to this. Like maybe, what's the Liberty Tavern? Or what's the Liberty Tree Tavern over in Magic Kingdom?
Liberty Tree Tavern and then the Golden Horseshoe.
Yeah.
I would say it looks, at least at first glance, it looks healthier. And we'll see how long this menu lasts. So for your salad options is a tomato salad, which is tomatoes, cucumbers, and pickled red onions tossed in a white balsamic vinaigrette and garnished with fresh dill. Or you can get Rex's romaine and kale salad. It has apples, pumpkin seeds, cranberries, and a green goddess dressing. And then they also have a watermelon salad, which is cubed watermelon and mint, which is also plant-based. So not your traditional salads or traditional sides.
I'll go with A and C.
I'll go with all three of those. They're fine.
I'm not a fan of kale, and
but you won't taste it. If it's not only kale, then you won't even know it's in there.
I'm also not big on fruit in my salad. Like the watermelon salad is really not a salad. It's watermelon and mint.
Oh yeah, by itself it'd be awesome. I'm kind of worried about the mint on it. I'd rather just go with the watermelon root, but
yeah, the meat options, quite a few, four different ones. So you have Evil Doctor smoked ribs, Buttercup's beef brisket, there's a sausage in my boot, and barbecue chicken with style. And the sausage in my boot looks like it's wrapped, like ringed. So it's put into more of a concentric circle and
Disney needs to come
grilled
up with,
that way.
Disney needs to come up with, they need to think about the things they call these things before they, like they need to put it to a group. There's a sausage in my boot.
Well, I'm sure they do.
Oh, yeah. So
I'm
why
sure they have to.
So why didn't they figure out that people were going to be calling Epcot Festival of the Arts farts?
I know, and Monsters Incorporated laugh for. I get it.
And
still,
aliens swirling saucers ass.
Buttercup's beef brisket, was it kind of like when I first heard that it didn't sound right, but fine. I'm okay with it. I like the chicken. The way they said they prepare it, it's brined for 48 hours. So you know that stuff's going to be good.
Probably. And if you don't eat meat, Jimmy, you can cover your ears. But if you're looking for some plant-based offerings, they offer three. A slow-smoked cauliflower, an oven-roasted, quote, bratwurst, and an impossible rib chop.
Listen, I don't want to offend anyone. But if you don't want to eat meat, don't go to a barbecue restaurant.
Well, you know what it is? That one family member that came along who doesn't want to eat meat. Mm-hmm. And I tell you what, the impossible rib chop, it looks, because it's got, it's wrapped around a sugarcane bone is what they call it. So it actually does look like a lamb chop a little bit. And it looks like a piece of meat. I mean, I have no idea how it would taste. But
I really want to try the slow smoked cauliflower. I love cauliflower as an alternative for like buffalo chicken. And that one looked really good.
Why does it have to be an alternative? I mean, that's a great side regardless.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah. Why does it? I like cauliflower. I would probably eat that. I'd want to eat that in addition to some meat. But I would still eat it, you know?
Mm-hmm. But you don't even need to, because wait until I get to the sides. I haven't even mentioned the sides. So you get to choose four. The marinated spuds, which is like a loaded potato barrel. So think your tater tots. Nice. Forest field fried pickles. I always go for fried pickles. So that's top one on my list. The slinky dog mac and cheese. The buck and baked beans. Cow poke corn on the cob. Mean old potato salad. Veggie slaw, which looks similar to sort of a shredded veggie type coleslaw, and then a campfire roasted vegetables.
Those roasted vegetables look good.
So now, slinky dog mac and cheese. Wouldn't you think they'd had sliced hot dogs in there?
That's immediately what I thought of. Maybe that's because I grew up broke, and that's, you know, my mom put hot dogs in mac and cheese, and she put it in spaghetti. And
but think about slinky dog though. That would be kind of horrific. Actually, we're eating him. So I guess I can understand why not.
Maybe that didn't go well with the taste testers.
Think if they took a hot dog though and cut it in like a spiral, like slinky dog. And then
that would be kind of cool.
Yeah.
Well, especially because you get to the desserts and you're going to eat Forky. So for your dessert, you can choose from a cupcake a la Forky, which
okay
looks like
trash.
That's true. But then do you want to eat trash?
Maybe that's even trash. Worse. Can't eat a slinky doggy, but I can eat trash.
There's a lemon and blueberry cheesecake, Billy's chocolate silk pie, Goat's apple pie, and Gruff's peach strawberry pie. I think that you just need to wear like your biggest stretchy moo moo pants and roll yourself out of here when you're done.
And what's crazy, and I mean, everybody's listening to audio, so they can't see the picture, but all those desserts are in like mason jars, so they're really going for that
cute
country
1 ounce mason jars,
little mason jars.
So they're really going for that that country barbecue thing.
And I won't get into all the cocktails, but there is a lengthy list of grown-up craft cocktails, both alcoholic and non-alcoholic.
Which are also in mason jars.
Sure.
It's true. And they have fruit.
Lime, watermelon, garnish
on
the margarita.
I'm down for this. I'm co-signing on this. Oh, my God.
November. We're going to get a reservation, and this is the 10th anniversary Disney Nerds. How much can you eat? And then go take a nap.
Not a bad
idea. I'm definitely renting the ECV.
Looks like bacon. So anyway.
That's the brisket.
It's March 23rd. It's when it opens up. They have not started accepting reservations yet, but I would expect that to happen any day.
We definitely need to plan this. Ed, we may have to plan this if we meet up in June.
Oh, yeah. No doubt.
I will rent an ECV because I won't be able to walk after this.
That's a good idea.
Right. And it is something else that Hollywood Studios needs, is that sit-down restaurant that's not the extreme, like, you know, the Brown Derby. And it's not one of those character breakfasts or dinners or stuff like that. So this is going to fit in hopefully well.
They totally needed another sit-down there.
Mm-hmm. I think everything else on the menu looks fantastic.
It does. It looks really, really good. Even the non-meat options look pretty good.
Okay. Something else that was announced this week, or actually just opened up, was the Disneyland's version of the Mickey's and Minnie's Runaway Train. And I guess it's the Runaway Railway. And I've kind of looked at a couple of the videos of it, and the ride itself looks very, very familiar to Walt Disney World. The queue, however, is a light year ahead. I guess just because they didn't have to deal with the old Chinese theater that was already set up with a queue, they had basically unlimited space inside there. They took advantage of it, and I think that's a pretty cool setup. Basically, you walk through all the different like sets and things like that from early Mickey Mouse cartoons and such.
Does it still have the magical pre-show?
I did not see that part of it in any of the reviews, but I gotta think they do.
I mean, because that's a cool part of.
Well, sure, that's the main part of it because that puts you right inside. There's a lot of, like I said, different things. It almost looks like the Toontown or kind of like Walt's One Man's Dream, where you have all these different artifacts around, and that's just like the line. I thought it was really cool because they have signs describing each of the items and what they are. What's cool is those signs are set up by instead of the Historical Society, they're set up by the Hysterical Society. I thought that was hilarious. Okay. So another bit of news that came out this week was something announced by Run Disney. Now, I have nothing to do with that ever as far as running goes, but I'm sure, Melissa, you have something to say.
Yeah, you still have a year to think about it, Ed, and perhaps train. But beginning next year, so 2024, if you complete any 10-mile race or longer at both Walt Disney World and Disneyland during the same calendar year, you're going to receive a Run Disney Coast to Coast Challenge Medal. Now, there's two ways that you can qualify next year for this. The first track is what they call it, is if you complete one of the following, a 2024 Walt Disney World Half Marathon or a 2024 Walt Disney World Marathon, any of the multi-event challenges as well. And then you complete a Disneyland Half Marathon in 2024. If you do that, you will get... Of course, we can all do it. I know.
You can do it, Ed. I got faith in you, man.
For the 11th anniversary.
Yeah, I'll be there a while.
If you participate in both of those, you'll receive a special Run Disney Coast to Coast Race Challenge Medal that's only going to be available in 2024. And then there's another option where you complete the half marathon during 2024's Disneyland Half Marathon plus any qualifying event at Disney World, including the Princess Half, the Springtime Surprise 10 Mile, the Springtime Surprise Challenge, or the Wine and Dine 2-Course Challenge. And if you do that, which is a little bit longer than Track 1, you'll actually receive a different and unique Run Disney Coast to Coast Race Challenge medal. So two different medals. And I guess if you really want to, maybe they need to come up with a name if you do both tracks. And it's I don't know. I mean, they have the Goofy and the Dopey Challenge. I don't know what else they could come up with if you did that many races in the year. But
the Hercules,
pretty fun.
Something
the Hercules, yeah, that's a good
something
one.
Big, yeah.
Just to hop back to the last story, Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway is in Toontown at the El Capitan Theater,
right?
And I went and looked it up because when you had mentioned that the stuff inside kind of looks like Toontown, it made me think, well, they just kind of redid Toontown and Disneyland, so maybe that's where it is. And sure enough, that's where it is.
Sure, that makes sense.
Yeah, it'll
fit. And that'll be opening up. The rest of Toontown opens up, I think, next month.
Cool.
Or soon. Okay, so now another big news story that came out this week, and I'm not sure how big a story this is, but I think Jimmy's going to give us an opinion on it. I heard the Star Wars Hotel down at Walt Disney World might be slashing all the prices.
Stop it.
So what's the deal?
So they came out with a deal, basically, that they'll give you a discount on a deluxe room for a pre-stay or post-stay. But they're not actually discounting the Star Cruiser, so they're not slashing prices at all.
Are there any discounts for Star Cruiser?
I think the only one currently right now is the only one they have is a DVC, and I think you have to be a Blue Card DVC member. So, like, I bought my DVC resale, so I don't have the Blue Card, so you don't get some of the perks. And I think it only applies if you have the Blue Card, and it's still not a crazy discount, like $700 or anything. So I think Melissa actually did some math on this against the current regular deluxe resort discounts.
Yeah, the deal right now, and there is a discount. It's not slashing when you think of, you know, the some of the taglines. To stay at the Star Cruiser is a two-night stay. It's a mandatory two. You can't go less. You can't go more. And so many guests will go ahead and book another resort on Disney property in order to extend their trip to do and enjoy other parts of the property. And so if you do that, you book your two nights at the Star Cruiser, and then you go and book a couple more nights at a deluxe resort, you can get up to a $700 credit for those deluxe room nights. Now, it is a savings. If that's what you were going to go do, that would be fine. If you're really looking for a savings, I think the deal that they have going on right now, where you get up to 25% off a deluxe resort, you would surpass that $700 savings after about 2.8 nights for most deluxe resorts. So if you're going to go down and you're wanting to stay at a deluxe resort, the 25% deal, book through Jimmy at Welcome Home Travel and save yourself some money that way. Otherwise, if you really want to go on that the Halcyon and experience the Star Cruiser, maybe you're going to save a little bit of money, but it's not slashing prices. They're still just doing just fine.
Yeah, I mean, they're not even really discounting the actual Star Cruiser at all.
Right. Well, I still have a hard time believing that they can do that and get away with it for the past year of people paying full price for it, not rebelling or somehow coming back looking for their discount too.
Well, you know, one of my things is, like, I feel like don't charge me for the ticket, like, discount it. I have an annual pass. Why do I? Because your Star Cruiser stay includes a one-day ticket to Hollywood Studios.
Yeah, but that's like $109 compared to this $2,400 per
you
person.
You said $109. Where are you going for $109? In 2018, maybe. This is 2022.
True. It's about $140.
Yeah, $140, and it's two people, so that's $280 that I'm paying for that gives me zero value.
Right. And we discussed this a couple weeks ago, where our theory is that this might go more of a one-day type of situation where they would remove things like that, the one-day pass for the park and other things like that. They would have to say you'd have to have your own pass to begin with, just like they do with most tours. So maybe we'll see what happens. Bottom line, I'm still not staying there anytime soon.
By the way, it also says up to $700. It does not say $700.
So right. I think it's declines if you have different resort classes, right?
Yeah, and it's probably so.
So it's going to be the highest level is going to be the $700, the highest of the highest level.
You save here. You go. You save $350 per night on Beach Club Resort, Grand Floridian Yacht Club, $250 per night at Animal Kingdom Lodge, Boardwalk Inn, Contemporary Polynesian and Wilderness.
Those
and
dives.
$150 a night at Coronado. So there is one little moderate in there.
Yeah, that is wild how they have that one. That's kind of a crazy one to have. Although that's the convention place. Maybe that's part of it.
So it's $700. You save up to $700 on a two-night stay at select Disney resort hotels when you book. So, I mean, I guess that is a discount, but like Melissa said, you break even with the 25% at 2.8 days. So it's really not that creative. I mean, it's still a little bit. And there's, by the way, there's very specific dates, sale sure. dates.
Which As there one. Always is. And again, if you were going, like Melissa said, then yeah, this is definitely kind of cool. You'll save a couple bucks. And I almost hesitate to ask this, but we did hear about that deal they're running. If you go for the 1 week in July or that 10-week period, and then the 3 or 4 weeks in end of August, early September, where you get the discount or not discount, but you get a food card.
Yes.
Do you know if the Halcyon falls into that category for your food card?
Your food's included in your $5,000, I thought.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Yeah, there is no food.
So you could use it in your second like part of your trip, but I don't think you could combine offers. I think you'd have to pick.
Okay. Combining the offers, that's the key right there again. You got it. Fair enough.
I thought the list was right here. I'm almost positive it's not included in no, okay, here we go right here. Bay Lake, Boulder Ridge, Copper Creek, Animal Kingdom, Boardwalk, Old Key West, Riviera, Saratoga, the Villas. No, it's not included. The Halcyon is not included in any of the deals. And that is also, again, depends on what dates you go. Certain dates at certain hotels, you get $150 per room per night on the dining card. Other dates and other hotels, you get $100 per night. And then there's also like values that you can go during certain dates that you get $50 per night on a card.
Very cool.
Always just remember it says up to, and that doesn't mean that's what you're getting. So just be careful with that.
Right. Okay. So another item that was released this week was a list of some of the items they're going to have at the Disney 100 exhibition that's going to be starting out in Philadelphia next month, which we kind of were wondering what it's going to be like and what's going to be at it. And basically, they released this list of 20-odd items out of the 250 that they're actually going to have at this show. And this list basically breaks down and kind of like, I guess, what we thought it was going to be. And I'll just list through a couple of the items going down here. A story script page from Steamboat Willie. So that'd be pretty cool to see just how they set that up. Visual development art for Alice in Wonderland. So basically what they use to let the artists draw. Concept drawing of Disneyland by Herb Ryman. So that's that original big painting that he did. The Nautilus special effects, the filming model. So you're going to see a model of the Nautilus. So definitely things like this and just more of it. Again, it's got a one man's dream feel to it. And they've got a lot of current stuff too. East High School Yearbook from High School Musical 3. A BB-8 puppet from Star Wars The Force Awakens. Captain America shield used in Captain America Civil War. Black Panther costume from the Black Panther. And this is kind of cool. They'll have attraction vehicles. A Matterhorn bobsled from Disneyland's park. And I'm sure they'll have a bunch of other stuff.
I feel like we could probably steal that. Go up to the top, that page. I'm thinking if what was the first thing on the list? Was it from Steamboat Willie?
Story script page from Steamboat Willie. Yeah,
I feel like if Nicolas Cage can steal the Declaration of Independence, me and you can get that, Ed.
Oh, no doubt, no doubt. All this stuff looks great. It definitely is going to be very, very interesting to see it. I did also note how D23's gold member. Has the opportunity to start out on the 15th of February, because I think the exhibit opens the 17th or 18th. But the 15th, they have a special D23 event where they're going to basically go through the entire exhibit, and they're going to have people talk about it, and they're going to have people speak. And it's to have the opportunity to go. You have to first be a gold member.
I'm a gold member.
Then it's $99 plus, I forget what the other charge was. And so I was looking into it, but here's the downer. It's 10 o'clock on Wednesday morning is when the event begins, and it goes from 10 to 1:30 on a Wednesday. So I was like getting ready to become a gold member, and I decided I'm not going to do that. So, which is fine. I have my membership at Franklin Institute. We're going to get our tickets to get our first viewing of it. And depending on how good it is, we'll probably go a second time. So, at least something to look forward to. And it goes through to August. And then it doesn't really say where it goes next. So, we're going to find out about that.
So, this travels.
Yes. I'm assuming it will. Usually,
yeah, when we
do.
Did our preview of it, I think it was in our maybe a September podcast where we, after we had heard about it at D23, there was indications that it is traveling through the US and maybe a couple stops in Europe, actually. But hopefully it's coming my direction, maybe a Chicago.
That Sleeping Beauty, like the original storybook that they open at the beginning of Sleeping Beauty, is in one of the Disney Plus shows, one of the archive show.
Oh yeah, yeah. Now they just seeing those artifacts.
Props.
Yeah, the prop. Oh yeah, yeah. Prop. Yeah, yeah. Yes, yes, the prop one.
It reminded me of Ken Anderson's place. 6-7 years ago, this guy helped do out those Waltz people books. He sent me to Sue Anderson, Ken Anderson's daughter's house out in Lancaster, and she had so much memorabilia, just like the list I had there. There were scripts, there were storyboards, there were awards, there were just like so much. It was just overwhelming.
And you left with nothing?
Oh, no, I definitely left with a couple of different items. She was very, very happy to give me a couple of things. I have a hand-drawn picture of Pete's dragon. I've got a Walt Disney Studios envelope, which is pretty cool because it's stupidly nerdy, but it's just an envelope from the Disney Studios. You know, a couple of things like that.
So you have a hand-drawn Peach Dragon done by Ken Anderson?
Yes. Yep. He had a lot of stuff. He had so much stuff going on as far as old Disney, but he was also so much into Epcot that there was just so much going on as far as that went too. So and really good stuff.
Did you see the documentary Frank and Ollie?
Sure. Yeah.
That's it. I mean, it's an older documentary, but they have so much stuff that they ended up having to like get filing cabinets and stuff like that because they wanted to keep
easily.
It for archival value, you know. And it's
I spent hours and hours scanning items.
I hope you have that framed.
I don't yet, but I'll show it to you when we get done. Okay, so Jimmy, you mentioned that Disney Plus show about the props. So I tell you what, I'm starting to get into Disney Plus and a couple different shows right now, and I think we're going to do this maybe once a month where we're going to talk about some of the shows we're watching on Disney Plus, not get too involved into it, but at least something, if you feel you would recommend this to a friend, we would kind of talk about it. So we're going to do that today. And I tell you what, I'm really getting into the Bad Batch season 2. If you're a Star Wars fan, or even if not, the Bad Batch has definitely been a great, great run so far.
I mean, I really enjoy the Bad Batch, and the Star Wars nerd in me is really excited for where it's going to go, especially from season 1, where you get to see Caleb Doom, which is very cool. So they could do so many spinoffs and things like that around that. But I would also say Andor. Andor's got to be one of my favorites. And I don't think that you have to be necessarily a Star Wars nerd to enjoy it, and I don't think you need any other context. Like, you could just watch. I mean, obviously, you'll get more if you watched Rogue One, but I think if you just watched Andor on its own without that knowledge, it's still enjoyable.
Sure, no doubt. I think these episodes, or how do I put this? I think these shows are a great way to connect the dots. The dots being the main movies. So now we're finding out what happens in those 10 years between the movies that happen, or the 5 years between each different edition of the movie, to help us figure out how everything got so extreme or how things changed and such like that. The Bad Batch is perfect for that. How basically the Clone Wars ended and the Empire took over and how they did it. And every episode kind of gives you a little hint into more of that, along with just the adventures of the Bad Batch themselves. So very, very good. I totally recommend that. I recommend watching season 1, obviously, but I also recommend going back and checking them out in that last season of the Clone Wars.
Yeah, for sure. Who's your favorite member of the Bad Batch?
That's tough. They're all good. I mean, Hunter, probably. I'd say yeah. Hunter.
I think Hunter's probably my favorite too.
Yeah, yeah.
But they are
pretty good.
Yeah, and I mean, they're all good for their own reasons, right? They're all so different. Sure. But
and here's the best part: they're all voiced by the same guy. In case you've forgotten,
freaking incredible, huh?
And this season, it's really gotten really good. The animation's incredible. Every time you see a close-up version or close-up view of the animation, you see it's like almost like a brushstroke type of animation. Very, very, very well done.
It's come a long, way though, you know. If you go back, because it's done in the same style that Clone Wars has done, but if you go watch the beginning of Clone Wars, it's much rougher. Like sure. You can see they invested more into it, cleaned it up quite a bit.
Well, it's funny because at the beginning of each episode of The Bad Batch, I'm waiting for the guy to come on. And it's like, yeah, the narrator, Obi-Wan Kenobi has found himself on this planet in the middle of nowhere, and Cody is going to help him out. And then they tune into it at the beginning of every Clone Wars. I keep waiting for that to happen on Bad Batch. So what else are you guys watching on Disney Plus?
I actually just finished watching Encanto at the Hollywood Bowl. So the Hollywood Bowl being an amphitheater, and they have the cast, at least a majority of the cast. There's a couple that aren't from the original movie. Lin-Manuel Miranda gives an opening, and it's beautiful. The stage is beautiful. They have a live orchestra. They do perform all the songs live with dancers and costumes. At one point, it kind of looked like they had drones flying, but maybe it was animation over the camera. I'm not really sure. It was just super fun, and we've been singing the songs over and over ever since.
Literally was like about to turn that on the other night, but then I think when you had recommended it to us, Melissa, you said bring your tissues.
Yes.
So I was not prepared for that at the moment. So I'm like, because I'm laying in bed about to go to sleep, I'm like, I don't want to cry myself to sleep tonight. So I'll wait and watch this later. But I remember you recommending it to us, and I do want to watch it. So I will. I wasn't prepared for that to be the last thing before I fell asleep.
I saw a couple minutes of it, and it totally made me think of a Disney show, a live Disney show, the way they had the animation that was broadcast on the sets and stuff like that, in the background and stuff like that. The projections. And it was really, really colorful. Very cool.
Very cool.
Yeah, it reminded me back in 2017, Hollywood Studios over the summer, I think it was, at night would do like a night at Pixar with the orchestra. I can't remember the name. But where Beauty and the Beast was performed. Yep. And you would go at night and they'd have a live orchestra. They'd have different Pixar segments of the film projected up. You'd have a character from the movie come out and interact, maybe dance, whatever, and the orchestra would play the song from the movie. Mm-hmm. And there were certain ones where there was not a dry eye in that theater, just like this was. And other times people are laughing, dancing, you know, singing along. So very similar to that. And it was just a really magical experience. I'm glad they put that on Disney Plus.
Yeah, very cool. Hey, you just reminded me too, before we went live tonight, I heard Coco is going to Broadway. It's going to be part of the Disney Broadway experience.
I saw that. I think they did the announcement at Farts during one of the Broadway shows. And I know we're going to be doing a trip report, but I saw Adam and Ariel Jacobs probably 5 times, and I was only in the park for 4 days. So some days I watched multiple sets, and I saw Kevin Massey and. Drawing a blank on his wife's name, but she's from Newsies. They were really good too, though.
Nice, very cool. We got a whole week to work on that, so get that ready for the report next week.
Kara Lindsay.
There you go.
I don't know where it came from. I don't know where it was. It was in here somewhere, but and they were so. Mark and Ariel Jacobs are brother and sister, and both play in Aladdin. Well, Mark Jacobs played Simba, and then he also plays Aladdin, and she plays Jasmine in the Australian production. and their brother and sister. And then Kevin Massey and Kara Lindsay are husband and wife, and they were the other duo that was there while we were there. So pretty cool.
Nice.
I've also been watching Disney's Animal Kingdom, which just dropped their second season, which is really cool. It's really cool to watch the cast members interact with the animals, and you get to see all kind of stuff behind the scenes, like the veterinarians working on them, doing different things, and how much care and stuff goes into that.
Best part of that show is that when you go on the train ride, you get to see some of those areas that they show on the show, because those pens and stuff like that. The hippos are back there. The giraffes are back there.
And, you know, when you said train ride, I was thinking you're right. You get to see that, like, and I don't know what they call it. It's not
Rafiki's Planet Watch.
Is it still Rafiki's Planet Watch? But you also get to see on the way back, you get to see where they keep all the animals, which is pretty cool, too. But going back to watching the Imagineering story, right around that same time, they were just building Splash, but now I'm at a point where they were building Animal Kingdom. And I didn't remember until watching this how much backlash they got.
As far as the zoo,
keeping animals in cages and stuff like that. But they really did a good job of partnering with people who really know. And I forgot the main lady's name, but
Jane Goodall.
She's in the documentary, and they really brought in, I mean, a lot of people gave them flack for building Animal Kingdom, but they really brought in a lot of experts to make sure that they did everything in the right way and making sure that they were keeping the right animals. Because some people say that certain animals should never be kept in captivity.
And you can see zoos across the country definitely changed the way they kept animals after this opened up.
Yeah.
I'm sure it just wasn't Animal Kingdom, but there were a couple of zoos at the time that started opening up that were just a big free, more big areas that were opened up and stuff like that. And even in Philadelphia, you could see that come, you know, the different areas come to our place too, based on it.
Absolutely. I mean, those animals in Animal Kingdom live better lives than some people.
I think you see that in season two, or you did in season one, but definitely in season two, their philanthropic work, the different charities that they either donate to, they continue research for, the wildlife conservation or rescue missions that they do in the Florida area. There's a number of turtles that are featured that they've either rescued or helping the hatcheries with. And I think that's what's really beautiful about them setting the standards for research and conservation and maintaining some of these species. And to Jimmy, your point of how long they live, there's quite a few birthdays they celebrate, and they talk about the average life in captivity for this animal was this, and look at how old this animal is now. It's really fascinating to watch.
They really invested a lot of time and money and resources into making sure that these animals are treated well, and they're doing the right thing by them. And a lot of them are rescues and never have lived in the wild. You know, a lot of these animals are not from the wild. They were born in captivity, and now they're in a better place. So,
sure. And how many shows do we come on announcing a new animal was born at the Animal Kingdom?
All the time.
Right. Right. Yeah, well,
it's great.
Morgan sent us a video the other day. She was on the safari, and there was a ton of rhinos. I just was amazed. Usually it's the three or four you see on the tour, but there had to be six or seven that were just like kind of flocking around the road right there. It was crazy amount. So very, very good stuff.
Well, one thing I love about this season, and one thing that I'm sad about this season, the thing that I'm sad, Josh Gad didn't return. So he's not the host or narrator this time, but the woman who is the narrator, she does a really nice job. It's just not Josh Gad. And then the thing that I really like is they've continued. It's not just Animal Kingdom. First season, they did a couple of animals featured over at Epcot, particular Seas with Nemo. But this season, you actually get a little Magic Kingdom hop over, particularly Grand Floridian with the ponies. And over at Fort Wilderness. Okay. So that was fun to see some of the other animals. And you do see the solar farm and some of the wild insects that live over there and that they're taking care of and monitoring.
Oh, cool stuff. You love that type of behind the scenes stuff.
Absolutely. It's very cool.
Yep. Okay, guys. So it's been pretty busy news week. If we missed anything, let us know. Send us an email. Jimmy, tell everybody how to get in touch with the show.
You can email us at questions at thedisneynerdspodcast.com and email us individually at ed@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, jimmy@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, etc. You can send us a message on Facebook to the page, The Disney Nerds Podcast. Join our group, Disney Nerds. Instagram at The Disney Nerds Podcast and Twitter at The Disney Nerds. Make sure to check out the website, www.thedisneynerdspodcast.com, and watch the live stream every Tuesday night at 9 o'clock Walt Disney World time.
Okay, guys, so that's it for show number 470, talking about the news in Walt Disney World. For Jimmy, for Melissa, this is Ed, and we're the Disney Nerds. We'll talk to you next week. Bye-bye.
Quaharini.
DTFM. Ta-ta for now.
Mortals pay a token fee. Rest in peace, the haunting's free. So hurry back, we would like your company.
Hurry back, hurry back.
By the way,
the thing I found.
Go ahead.
The if thing I found interesting not, is...
You can't right, say go I'm ahead and talk.
You can't say go work. Ahead.
That well, you said work. Go ahead, too. We both said go ahead.
Okay, all right. Jimmy, go.
All right, so interesting enough, and if you have not seen it, I highly recommend.
Boy, I think someone's going to throw the red flag here. We're going to have to find out who I said first, right?
He said you Jimmy first. Bet.
No, he said for Jimmy, for Melissa.
Oh, wait. I'm so confused.
I think you just answered that. Okay, end recording.
Right, so it might have been me. I thought it was who you.